Dr. Nick Delgado, and I'm with Dr.
Anil Bajnath.
And we're here to talk to you about microscopy. We're looking at an observation tool that allows you to get a perspective of what is the effect of your diet, your exercise, your supplementation, even your genetics. Doctor, there's all kinds of factors we can see, and I know you've been studying blood under an observation microscope for what, more than nearly 20 years?
Yeah,
I've been looking at it for nearly 40 years. And so, you know, with our combined knowledge, this is our first show, second podcast together, because we're going to pop that up to a podcast show. But we were comparing notes. Tell me about your background. What, you have a fascinating background because you had an early fascination in microscopy, but then you took a number of courses in route to your MD degree. So talk about your background and your training.
Oh, thank you, Nick. So, interesting story. The way I got exposed to clinical microscopy first started when I was in high school. I was wrestling in high school, and my wrestling coach got me exposed to this form of microscopy because he knew I was working at a Whole Foods market selling supplements in their little whole body vitamin area. So he introduced me to this technique of what he called nutritional microscopy, and it kind of just stuck with me for a few years and made the leap forward by pursuing additional training in this technique by going to biomedics in Chicago for my initial course at the age of 19. From there, I got certified, purchased a microscope, and pursued different trainings in the field of both conventional and or integrative alternative red blood cell microscopy. So during undergrad, I went to the University of Central Florida. I did a double major in molecular microbiology and medical laboratory sciences, which gave me the conventional tools of what's of looking at hematology under the conventional norms. But that was built upon the initial training in live blood cell nutritional microscopy. And then from there, I pursued a few additional trainings and courseworks with functional blood chemistry with Apex Energetics and Datis Karazian. I also pursued a two-year training course with Paracelsus Clinical Biological Medicine with Dr. Thomas Rao, who uses this form of microscopy in his clinical practice and subscribes to the Enderlin model. You know, that's a term that we are familiar with in a philosophical perspective of looking at the various bacterial morphologies under the scope there. And so I did that. And then also, you know, it was interesting. I actually went and studied with Dr. Peter D'Adamo and completed a course with him with the Institute for Human Individuality, which was co-sponsored by Southwest College of Naturopathic Medicine at that time. And that really instilled additional tools and thought processes in regards to how to view live blood cell and correlate it to some of the concepts that he built on in regards to eating right for your blood type. Now, I don't endorse this diet specifically, but I do believe that there is some merit to it in regards to lectin chemistry. And I developed that appreciation for lectin chemistry while working at immunohematology lab or blood bank during undergrad. We were able to differentiate the difference between an A1, A2 phenotype just by the bean lectin. So it's the same sugar molecule in composition, but there's a double bond in it that causes it from being straight to go kinked. And that unique little lectin could bind with high affinity to that double bond and cause the agglutination of red blood cells. So that made me realize the sensitivity and specificity of the dietary lectins and how that influences the picture that we see under the microscope, and makes me believe that there is some level of association with blood type and lectins and that agglutination process. So I finished a master's certificate with the Institute for Human Individuality. I finished those additional trainings in German New Medicine with the Swiss clinic. Molec Micro, Med Lab Sciences, and pursued all the other functional medicine training, all prior to starting medical school.
Wow.
So needless to say, starting med school was fun, knowing this kind of perspective and going through that conventional model. And I carried that forward and built an appreciation of both the conventional with the integrative world, you know? And
I can see you raising your hand during medical school. I have a comment about that. Professor, let me ask you this, right?
Yeah.
You know, it really, at seeing the blood at the cellular level, I think you grow to appreciate the origin and pathology and also what it takes to be in optimum health. Because I think I, like you, I've seen literally tens of thousands of samples in 40 years of my work, yeah. Having trained with Dr. Bradford, one of the early pioneers, and looking at microscopy, and Dr. Ron Duvendeck from Germany, who was amazing in his work, and their understanding of Heaton and Lagarde, the original doctors who were President Eisenhower's physicians, who were describing things they were seeing in the blood. And of course, microscopy has its origin more than 100 years ago. I mean, when they were looking at water, and they're thinking water, you know, what are these little things wiggling around in the water? And so, yeah. You know, we start to realize that there's an importance. Where I gained the biggest appreciation was I was trying to figure out how do I integrate using microscopy with the doctors that I train, because I do and have administered courses CME level for doctors to get accreditation and continued education credits. And I thought, well, wait a minute. If you're going to register with a microscope, it's going to be a very complex thing. You're going to have a pathologist. It's a very expensive procedure. And I thought, well, wait a minute. I read the studies, Dr. Meyer Friedman, type A, type B personality, the author of that book. And he was looking at firemen. And he described early on, I believe it was in the 1960s, he said, you know, we give a fireman a microscope exam of the capillaries in the eye. And they had a special device that would hook up, and you could see. And you could see the smallest capillaries. We even have a little device in our office where you put it up to your fingernail, and you can pick up the capillary beds. And so they would literally take in real time, because some people would question under a cover slip, what are you really seeing? Have you altered it? Have you changed it? So Dr. Meyer Friedman had these firemen come in on a baseline, basically fasting. They all had their triglycerides measured, which I advocate, get a lipid procedure done. We use a cholestatic device, because in 5 minutes you get a stat, an immediate result within 5 minutes. And we would look at these people of a baseline. And then, according to Dr. Meyer Friedman, he had them drink a glass of heavy cream. Mm-hmm. Every fireman, all at the same time, they all drank a glass of heavy cream. They then measured their blood each hour for on the hour, and they looked at the capillary beds. Sure enough, triglycerides went up significantly. Within a period of time, the blood cells were clumping from the massive amount of cream fat in the blood. And they measured these elevated triglycerides, which is floating fat in the blood, and the blood cells stuck together. And at the capillary levels, as you know, red blood cells, if you can cut away to the microscope, because we have an actual sample here that we're looking at, these individual red blood cells, if you move the cursor, doctor, we can actually the cursor right here, just move it around one of the red blood cells. There you go. That's so, and next to it is what's called Brownian movement. It's hitting molecules smaller than we can see, and it's causing these fatty particles or food particles to move around, and triglyceride. So there's three glycerol molecules, which are fatty molecules. That's the way fat transports in the blood, right? So when these triglycerides, which this individual had a triglyceride on the stat test of 148, which I tend to find in the middle of the day that this individual already ate breakfast, but it was a lean breakfast. It was like potato with no oil in it, with some rice, I believe, a few other things that might have included some fruit last night. And so it's a very, very clean diet for this individual. So in the middle of the day, his triglycerides are 148, which is respectable. It's low enough that it hasn't caused the blood cells to coat together, to stick together. And so we know that from an observation standpoint, let's say we measured his blood after postprandial after eating, there's a higher correlation to what a person eats than to fasting tests. So I encourage practitioners to also measure people, not just fasting, like Dr. Meyer Friedman did, was measure it after they've consumed something. So Meyer Friedman went on to then, after he found cream, heavy cream, as you'd expect, caused massive buildup of fat in the blood that lasted for between 6 to 8 hours and sometimes as long as 12 hours. He had them try vegetable oil, and he tried a few different vegetable oils, olive oil, safflower oil, same thing. The oils mechanically are sticky. It didn't matter if they were polyunsaturate, monounsaturate. These fats, even though some would describe certain fats as healthier than others, too much concentrated oils or fats will clump the blood together. Meyer Friedman published that paper. It was in the medical journal Lancet, and ever since then I thought, all you have to do to prove to people that that may be the origin of thickening of the blood, high blood pressure, it may be the origin, Pritikin theorized, of early signs of cardiovascular disease, restricted blood flow, and then cholesterol would get into the walls of the arteries due to the opening of the artery walls to let in more in the endothelial lining, atherosclerotic plaques or cholesterol that would form plaques. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of discussion about that. And so I always want practitioners to say, look, don't trust what the patient tells you. I follow a healthy diet. What's a healthy diet? Who knows these days, right? It's all over the place.
Yeah. Oh, I agree. And I think you really elucidated on the pathways and mechanisms by which the atherosclerotic process takes place. And just circling back to that with this transient hypertriglyceridemia, if you were to actually break down, you know, the beginning processes and the smallest particulate matters of lipids as they enter the bloodstream, they build. So everything, it's a building process and a deposition process. Again, there's different mechanical forces that influence that deposition process. There's the turbulent flow of the blood, which lead to microangiopathic lesions that thereby lead to the deposition and trigger these this inflammatory cascade that leads to ultimately atherosclerosis, foam cells and everything else. And then ultimately that calcified cap, there's this whole progression of it towards that, which is well established. And if you were to look at the work of Dr. Virchow in regards to, it's not necessarily the LDL, but the oxidation of that LDL,
right,
which is going to have the most atherogenic potential, is also very important to take into account because it's the environment, it's a milieu. And once we start viewing things in regards to that milieu and how that terrain is influenced in regards to redox potential, oxidative stress, and just a pH and everything else, that could lead to all sorts of interesting biological processes. So, yeah.
You alluded to something that's quite important that I think is often overlooked, and that is that when people are being evaluated, you look at worldwide population studies, where does atherosclerosis tend to be prevalent? Where is it least likely?
Yeah.
And it's interesting, India, it was always a paradox to me because I thought, here they are, largely vegetarian, yet they use ghee, which is clarified butter. One of the recent paper came out showing that ghee is one of the highest concentrated levels of oxidative particles of LDL. And sure enough, they would trace the exact particles and it would show up in the heart, in the brain tissue, in various areas. So an Indian diet, which might be considered rather healthy overall as a plant-based center diet, but it could be marred or destroyed or ruined and lead to cardiovascular disease that I saw in the Indian population. I've spoken in India, and we had patients there were the doctors I was training, and they would tell me, it's perplexing. Why are they vegetarian? Why do they have heart disease? Why do they have high blood pressure?
Yeah.
And I'd say, look at how you cook with so much oil. It's just your food swimming in oil. And what do you think that is? It's ghee, and ghee is one of the highest levels of oxidized cholesterol there is. So we really have to look at each population. So I tend to lean towards the populations that have the best health, because people always point to the Mediterranean. They'll say, oh, the Mediterranean. But what do they eat? First off, they eat a lot of garbanzo beans. Beans have been shown to be very healthy center to a diet. A lot of fiber, nutrient density. They eat tomatoes, they eat vegetables, they go to a fresh fruit stand, right? They get their vegetables right there, they walk every day. But they use olive oil, and people say, oh, but olive oil must be good. Not necessarily, because you look at those who eat whole olives instead of olive oil, and you look at those who drink wine versus those who don't, and you eat the grapes instead of the wine.
Yeah.
So it's all about processing, because there are cultures in Vietnam that don't use hardly any oil, and they cook with very, very light. If you get Asian pho soup, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
yeah, you don't see oil swimming around in that.
No.
But you go to other cultures, there's oil like, you know, this thick, and if you refrigerate it, it cakes. That same stuff cakes in your arteries.
Oh,
it thickens your blood. So
falls out of suspension. Absolutely.
So it's interesting that you and I have a love for food, a passion for traveling, and enjoying cultures. I think I've enjoyed every kind of cuisine in the world because I've collected all these cookbooks. I've traveled all over the world. And when I do eat certain foods, when I'm at those cultural extravaganza cuisine experiences, I'm very selective. They're saying, you know, here's all the vegetable dishes with the spices and sauces. And I look at them very closely and I say, and these have meat. And I'll say, okay, I'm going to have a taste of it. I want to experience, you know, the flavor, whatever, but a taste. That's mostly garbanzo and beans and vegetables. I'm going to have a big plate of that.
Yes.
So when you travel, you just have to learn to proportion your meals. Even if you think, okay, this is what this culture eats and they're a healthy culture, before you go that far to say, make that comment, you know, what do they eat in Okinawa? In the early days, they had a healthier Okinawan diet. Now they eat more pork, more Americanized, more fast foods. So, you know, it's not what it was when I read the early papers, when I was looking at research, working with Nathan Pritikin, because I was only, 23 years old working with him. And that was 40 years ago, right? So, you know, if you look at 40 years ago and then look at the papers that were reprinted from worldwide studies, you saw even cultural differences with Eskimos and various cultures. So people can't be so quick to say and point to a culture and say, see, they're healthy. Look at the Eskimos and the central continent. And they eat a lot of vegetables, but the outer continent, they eat a lot of blubber and they're not as healthy.
Yeah, yeah. Well, and I think it's very interesting also to look at things from a paleo and ancestral paleo perspective in regards to what their native diet was in that area, and also how things kind of co-evolved with the land. You know, I think that, you know, especially in today's modernized industrial world, there are a lot of other factors leading to environmental influences on how we respond to the food. Remember that food is information. It carries with it a unique communication that communicates with our genes and has an epigenetic potential.
Wow.
So knowing that, the intelligence behind the foods that we are consuming and how it affects our gene expression, I think it's going to be very important to look at things in the context of, you know, traditional ethnic cuisine and how things were done historically and traditionally. And there's also a mind-body component. You alluded to the environment, we're just consuming these foods when you travel, whether or not, you know, there's meat and the sauce and there's oil and all that other good stuff. But just you're practicing mindfulness practice right there.
Yes.
You know, just being more conscious and aware of the decisions that you're doing and how it's going to affect you. It's just a cause and effect relationship. And just being more aware, conscious, and mindful of these decisions as you travel, as you eat out and experience life is going to be very important. And at the same time, being mindful of that concept of internal terrain. Are you creating and promoting balance? Are you seeking, you know, some sort of, you know, balance in regards to, well, I had some red wine, you know, don't want to indulge too much, but, you know, and you try to balance it out with food and water and hydration and all those other factors. So again, going back to some of these mechanisms, for example, you mentioned ghee, its oxidized potential, and its heat index versus olive oil versus all these things. Well, we have different fatty acid structures, and it influences our lipidology, our internal lipid dynamics, right? And how we respond. You know, there's a strong amount of evidence looking at various polymorphisms or gene SNPs, single nucleotide polymorphisms, which refers to specifically a gene variant in a gene that codes for whatever protein. And this protein has a function, and that function could influence enzyme activity and all this other stuff. But going back to this concept of nutrigenomics, where we're looking at these various SNPs and how they influence our body's response to environment, it's very individualized, right? So if we know that somebody has a ApoA2 polymorphism, they shouldn't be consuming more than 22 grams of saturated fat, right? So if we know that, you know, somebody else has a FTO or a PPR gamma alpha polymorphism, it's going to influence our macronutrient intake and tolerance, theoretically.
Right. So looking at this client, if you can get a little better focus, I want you to kind of identify structures and kind of move the blood around a little bit. But I also want to mention that he came up with a HDL of 60, which is a good HDL, good cholesterol. The total cholesterol, though, is 269. And I can see here that his LDL, the bad cholesterol, if you will, is 179. And so anything over 100, Stanford had published some studies that HDL was no longer protective once the LDL got over 95. So I happen to know this particular individual's eating a lot of egg yolks under the mistaken belief that he's going to get his best source of protein and manufacture additional hormones with the eggs, which is, you know, some of the practitioners practitioners are very confused. They don't understand that the liver produces the most cholesterol every cell. The body makes cholesterol. You don't have to consume cholesterol to get a production. Unlike vitamin C, which you have to get a source of vitamin C, the body has an infinite source of cholesterol, but it stays in a narrow range of 100 plus your age and over, not over 160, according to Pritikin and Caldwell-Esselstein, who does his work at Cleveland Clinic and other researchers. So we look at his ratio of LDL to HDL, which is 3.0. We'll put this up on the screen later, which is considered generally good because he has a little bit more HDL. But again, those studies are now showing that when that LDL peaks up over 95, which his is 179, and observation from the blood, you and I know cholesterol is dissolved in the blood. It's like a hormone. You're not going to see it in the blood like triglycerides. So you have to explain to the person when you're doing this lipid profile that part of the lipids in denotes like it's fat, but it's not exactly. Cholesterol is a waxy sterile substance. It's a hormone-like substance, much like vitamin D. So vitamin D isn't even really a vitamin, it's a hormone, correct?
Yeah. Yeah.
So we're looking at his overall blood profile, and what concerns me is his blood sugar is only 98, which is excellent in the middle of the day. Mm-hmm. What concerns me is he's been led to this faulty belief that eating eggs somehow was beneficial. Well, in a person that he said he has a history of pre-diabetes for years, he has a high hemoglobin A1C, he's got all those risk factors that when cholesterol does enter his system, it's going to pack into the arteries far worse. He's going to be at greater risk for blindness, hearing loss, which he's already has some elements of hearing loss, even though I think he's approaching 50. It doesn't say his age here, date of birth. I'd have to back check on that because I should know his birth date, but whatever.
You should.
I should.
You really should.
We won't go into that. But his total cholesterol terrifies me because if he goes off the egg yolks, I predict, and I'm going to task him to do this, it only takes 10 days to lower cholesterol about 30, 40%. And I know people are shocked to find that, but you have to be a total cholesterol-free diet.
Yeah.
You can't just do the American Heart Association, I'm going to eat an egg a day, I'm going to have a little cheese, I have up to 300 milligram allotment. You don't. The body, according to Pritikin, in his early review of all the medical literature to date at that time, and I've since continued to monitor it from 40 years after, was that the body has a leak valve of cholesterol. The brown color of the bowel movements is bile, and that's made up principally of cholesterol. Our body excretes about 100 milligrams of cholesterol a day. So that means, unlike a rabbit that doesn't excrete any cholesterol, which you can kill a rabbit pretty quick feeding them egg yolks. You feed a human, we got a outlet valve, a little. But if an egg is 240 milligrams of cholesterol and the body only gets rid of 100, simple math is he's accumulating. And where is it accumulating? And if it's oxidized, it's even worse. It's in his heart, coronary heart disease, to the brain, a stroke, to the eyes, cataracts, the back of the blood vessels. I have a good ophthalmologist, Dr. Mark Rose, who talks about that. They see these shiny crystals. What is that? That's cholesterol in the capillary beds, right?
Yeah.
If it's in the peripheral of the feet, they get gangrene. They're going to have to amputate his leg. His fingers are starting to show very little feeling at the end. So he's got neuropathy going on, right? I mean, he's got certain things. So, and his thyroid's clinically low, and he's afraid of bioidentical hormones. Why? Because someone told him, as you age, you don't need hormones. In this day and age, you can get Mexican yam, synthesize it from a plant, make it identical to what the human body is, and then go to a optimization based on 24-hour urine, on blood, and saliva for cortisol. But look at these things, balance them, not in super physiologic like an athlete, like a steroid user. And steroid, by street definition, steroid is a hormone, but they use it, which is synthetically different, and they use super high levels because they want, you know, superhuman performance, right? We're not talking about that, are we?
No.
What do you feel about hormones, and do you think this might help clinically with this person with apparent autoimmune disease, possibly Raynaud's, possibly pre-diabetes, possibly heart disease? Could he make some changes in his diet, intervene with his hormones? Could we do some counseling on him and follow up with the 24 urine 30 to 60 days later? Is this something that you would do and anything you would add for this patient? And then please open field now. You got the field. Look at the microscope. Talk to us about clinical tests because you were really good about saying, hey, one thing is the microscope's an observation, but now we got to go further.
Sure.
What do we do next?
Sure. Well, that's a lot. You know, everything you just said was a lot. And I do believe there is a therapeutic order.
Yes.
And I do believe that, you know, this is a great observational tool that could capture a snapshot of what's transpiring on a biochemical level and is our window into assessing this milieu.
Yeah, don't worry about it.
So with that, I think that with all that being said, I don't like to necessarily just treat numbers. I like to look at root cause.
Yes.
So I would like to personally delve into all sorts of root cause issues and what's mediating these biological processes. Do I believe there's a role for HRT, hormone replacement therapy? Sure.
You know? BHRT.
Biological hormone.
Because
sure. Bioidentical. Yep.
Because otherwise, HRT yep. could be confused with synthetic
exactly.
pharmaceutical,
exactly.
which has been altered for patent reasons, right?
Exactly. So, yes, I do agree that BHRT has a role in all of this, but I think that's a little bit downstream to begin with. And, you know, again, this is not my patient that I'm actively managing, and I'm kind of now familiarizing myself with this case and a little bit of the information. And the background information in regards to, you know, what's brought him to this place currently. However, just taking a step back and looking at the blood,
yes, please.
You know, I think that there's a lot to be said with this picture. So, you know, one thing, just going back to what we are able to identify definitively under the blood is red cells
yes.
and their various morphologies, platelets
yes.
and their
morphologies, the shape denoting the quality of the nutritional status
yep.
of the red blood cells, okay.
And white blood cell.
Yes.
Okay, and there's different attributes that we could look for at each and every component of these formed elements in
right.
living blood. With that being said, I think it's, you know, and also the plasma, the fluid in which these cells are floating around in.
Yes.
And what's hanging out there. And also whether or not we're seeing what appears to be bacterial forms. I think that's very important. Actually, a very important component of my training and, you know, my earlier training as a young scientist and all that good stuff,
yeah.
It was seeking out what are we really looking at, you know? So first and foremost, over the years, I've accumulated various amounts of information, as have you. We were just sharing behind the scenes just now all the different resources and trainings and manuals and workshops and
hundreds and hundreds
oh my
of
gosh.
Hours. You can
truly
together years, right?
Seriously.
Yeah.
And it's quite impressive to see the evolution of our understanding of microbiology over the years, because just going back to the work of Dr. Enderlin, Anton Bechamp,
yep.
Germ theory as a whole with Louis Pasteur,
yes.
and just that argument about, you know, whether it's a microbe or the terrain and how that environment influences a big picture. And, you know, bringing it back and circling back to where we're at today and our understanding of the pathophysiological process
right.
that mediates a lot of this disease has evolved tremendously. Are we seeing bacteria? Are we seeing fungus? Are we seeing signs of oxidative inflammatory stress? Yeah, we're seeing that right now in this snapshot.
Can you use the cursor, please, and then point out what you call anaerobic fermentative bodies?
So yeah, go on.
The white spots, yeah.
So they're actually scattered here in the cytoplasm, these little blebs of formed elements. I believe, especially when they're aggregated into various pockets like this one here.
Oh, look at that.
You know, some people like to call this fungus. And I think that's, you know, and there has been immunohistochemical staining performed
yes.
by Dr. Majid Ali, who's, I believe, still in practice, Columbia-trained pathologist, mm-hmm. who worked with Robert Bradford
wow.
At Capital Integrative back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
He did the immunohistochemical staining to verify that it was lighting up to Candida albicans
wow.
historically. However, I'm a little bit more reserved to say, yeah, that's Candida. And I'm going to say, you know, what's mediating this process is
right.
anaerobic fermentation. But also dialing back, you know, in the sample, there's also additional forms that we were identifying.
Well, hold on before you change. You see that form right there?
This
yes,
one?
With a tail.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Some thoughts or feelings?
I do believe that as the slide sits and
yes.
time goes on, there are going to be releasing of myelin products,
okay.
right? The actual architectural components that make up actin, myelin, myosin, all these different subcomponent proteins that are found that give the architectural cell type its structure and form break down. Some will say this is an advanced form with a bacteria
mm-hmm.
Theoretically coming out of solution and seeking nutrition,
right,
or advanced valency or pathogenic form or whatever you want to call it.
Right.
I've seen different clinicians, especially the Europeans, the Germans, mm-hmm. The work of Maria Blecker, Beaker, mm-hmm. The work of Gunther Enderlin, going back to the German physician. And others that looked at and identified these forms specifically in different processes, disease processes. So I'm a little bit more conservative and reserved, and I don't like to make those like big jumps in using terminology that's not conventionally accepted.
Sure.
Especially being an MD, conventionally trained, I gotta operate within an area of conservative, evidence-based, classification. So
sure.
I'm less compelled to say that is a microbe, a parasitized cell with a microbial form. Whether or not it's a Lyme disease spirochete, I'm not going to get into that. However, it doesn't look good, right? And
right.
I'll leave it at that, right?
Exactly.
There's something going on,
right?
Right. So going back now to, especially in the era of precision medicine and with functional medicine and everything else, and our understanding of the digestive process and how there is something called leaky gut syndrome or
yes.
increased gut permeability, which is really prominent in the literature. Mm-hmm. And that mediates all sorts of downstream autoimmune, inflammatory, and different infectious processes. That's something I would be looking at right now, is because once we have this pro-inflammatory food, whether it's egg yolk or whatever it might be, that's triggering this increased gut permeability, breaking those tight junctions. So the way it works, you have your gut lining, right? And that gut lining is held together by what's called tight junctions, and forms a barrier. And it allows selective permeability to various food components, macro, micronutrients, into circulation. Right? Sometimes that barrier is broken. And there are different levels to that barrier, actually starting with the microbiome. That microbiome feeds off, these secretory IgA components that lines the gut, and they ferment different foods to give butyrate, which feed the colonocytes and creates this beautiful, dynamic, harmonious environment of the gut. Right, so just going back to the gut and looking at what could lead to this disruption of gut permeability and everything else, which causes a transient endotoxemia, is something that needs to be looked at. And this is well documented in the literature.
Yes.
There are articles that look at specific foods, fast foods, and oils that lead to a high prevalence of lipid A in the blood, or what's known as transient endotoxemia. It's in the literature. So knowing that, that mediates a lot of the things that we could be potentially seeing in the gut or in the blood. Mm-hmm. And also, if you were to look at the literature now, there are the research in the field of the microbiome is expanding beyond the oral cavity, the digestive cavity, and the skin, and the genitourinary system. And it's now looking at the blood microbiome. Yeah. We are taught that the blood is sterile, right? That mm-hmm. is not the case.
Wow.
That is a very controversial topic, but if you were to look at the literature, there is publications coming out. There is a wonderful publication that came out of McGill University that looked at identification of unculturable bacteria in the blood. They were looking at a molecular technique using DNA, mm-hmm. PCR, polymerase chain reaction, and they're identifying the 16S ribosomal DNA of these microbes, and they can't culture it. So what are we, and if you were to look at mycoplasma, these cell wall mm-hmm. deficient forms, that's very difficult to culture. So depending on what we're seeing in the...
When you say it's difficult to culture, the concern is to be able to identify that it's a true pathogen within the system of the individual versus some external microbe that somehow entered the slide, or what are you trying to say on that so that the audience can get a handle on that?
So again, there are different microbes that live in different places that do different things and come about for different reasons.
Right.
So for example, like if you were to look at somebody who has recently taken a beta-lactam antibiotic like penicillin,
okay.
right? What's the mechanism of action? It inhibits what's called NAGNAM, which are proteins, and cross-linking, right? So these glycoproteins are unable to cross-link, right? And it doesn't kill the bacteria. They're bacterial static versus bacterial cytal. So there are different forms and mechanisms for example, with antibiotics. And that inhibition of NAGNAM cross-linking prevents that microbe from dividing in its normal state, normal nature, thereby leading to theoretically undergo a burst. All right, it doesn't kill it, but the osmotic gradient is dampened, and the microbe can no longer maintain its cellular structure or integrity because of that decreased cell wall, right? And now it theoretically bursts. Well, sometimes it doesn't burst, mm-hmm. right? And right. now you're led with this cell wall deficient form, right? If you look at the work from Dr. Lida Matman, I think she was from Yale. She was from one of the Ivy League schools in the Northeast. And she wrote a book called Cell Wall Deficient Stealth Pathogens, and looked at how there are all these various forms that take place and what contributes and mediates this. And there's all sorts of things. So circling back to what we were discussing initially, there are different forms of bacteria that could be identified in the blood doing different things. And there are different gold standard molecular diagnostic techniques that will give you a true microbiological diagnosis of what we're observing. And this technique is used amongst various practitioners with various backgrounds and training and levels. And I think it's very important to be responsible with the information that we're garnering from this and delivering it in a responsible manner. Because right. we could sit here and be like, oh man, you've got some cancer going on or something. And people, no, you can't say that. You can't say that stuff, you know? You right. have to be very responsible with the language that's being used when using this technique, and is the reason why it hasn't gained conventional mainstream acceptance is because there's too much variation. So, and not to, you know, toot my own horn or whatever, but, you know, I wanted to overcome those barriers. Right. And I originally wanted to pursue hematopathology, right, in my training, but it's boring, you know? Like, I really enjoy speaking to people. I enjoy sure. getting to know somebody and working beyond just the microscope and everything else, delving into, you know, the actual person and the individual and what's their story and what brought them to this place of their current state of health. So with all that being said, you know, just looking at the microbial diversity, keeping in mind these concept of increased gut permeability, especially what's a major bacteria of the gut, you know what I mean? It's mostly a lot of gram-negative rods, right?
Okay. Like you see that little form that rod form.
Yeah, so, you know, once you start seeing these little things and these pockets and everything else, candida lines our entire GI system, right? Mm-hmm. Potentially, if the environment and terrain's conducive to their growth, because there's excess dietary sugar, it's an anaerobic fermentative environment, and all that other stuff, you're going to have a dysbiosis or imbalance of gut flora, and which leads to transient migration, especially if there's this inflammatory response and increased gut permeability. And I think that's what we're observing in the blood, and that's giving rise to the blood microbiome.
So scan around a little bit more. Are there any other structures that are either alarming or important to identify so that the audience understands that red blood cells should be round and uniform? There should be a certain number of white blood cells. Not that we're doing actually a white blood cell count here, but there appears that white blood cells, there should be one white cell for every, say, 200 to 500 red cells. And we're seeing about one white cell in this particular sample from this patient client that there's almost one white cell for every almost 50 red cells. So it tells us that his body is reacting, and it may be normal for him, but he's having symptoms. And those symptoms are related to these granular sites, these particular basophils, eosinophils. And we're looking at these white cells that might be exposed to certain foods that maybe has an inflammatory or certain environmental components that he's having trouble excreting. So whether you buy into far infrared spa or using certain methods to detoxify, massive amounts of fiber, whole food eating, lots of fresh water, lots of fresh fruit, cleaning them free of pesticides and toxins. I mean, there's a lot of things that can go into helping to optimize this individual, because what another person may consume and kind of handle without manifesting symptoms or disease or breakdown of skin or causing pain in the hands or the feet or back and all these symptoms this gentleman's having, we see this going on. And so something is causing overreactivity. So you worked with a gentleman that I guess was doing skin patch tests, the early, what do we call that, RAS test, the skin patch?
Yes.
And that's an interesting way of looking IgE. I've talked with Dr. Dan Danatelli, who's published in NIH, and he's got several papers I'm going to share with you, but he's looking at IgG reactions and how does a certain food exposed to white blood cells, you know, does it react? And I actually did split tests. You'll appreciate this. I drew a person, five people's blood, sent it to three different laboratories, did a ALA test out of Florida, did a, I believe it was a RAS test,
ALCAT test?
ALCAT, yes.
Yeah.
And then I did a Sage Medical test with Dr. Dan Danatelli and a Monarch Beach test, which was done with Dr. Mark Lovendale at that time. And so we pulled together the samples, and then I looked for what was the consistency. Did this person have a reaction to eggplant? Did all three tests show he had a reaction to eggplant? Did he have a reaction to gluten? Did all three tests show the same? And so I created a graph, and it was amazingly close. The test was kind of like a linear graph and a few outliers. And I'm like, okay, is that test correct? Or is that individual? Or is that test more sensitive or less sensitive? You know, what's going on with that? So I took that into account, and I said, there might be something to this. For three different tests on the same blood draw to go to three different laboratories and to pick up with different lab testing technologies, it made me then tie it back into what was this person's symptoms? How did that relate to?
Sure.
So autoimmune disease is big. Yeah. It's a big problem, isn't it? Hashimoto's, where your own body's attacking its own thyroid or it's attacking its skin, psoriatic psoriasis, or ankylosis spondylosis, you know, the joints, right? I mean, that's just a few of the autoimmune diseases. Let's elaborate a little bit on this whole autoimmune thing and what's your feeling about it?
Well, you know, going back to what we were discussing initially is, you know, why does the immune system turn on itself?
Right.
What's that triggering event, right? So, you know, you mentioned specific diseases that have a genomic component to it, HLA-B27, and that is well documented in conventional medicine and literature that these are various autoimmune-like conditions which has a genomic component to it. So what tips somebody into autoimmunity and causes this acute reaction or flare or whatnot for the body to start responding to and attacking itself?
Right.
You also mentioned the different levels of testing for allergies and food allergies and everything else, and that's a very controversial topic of discussion right now, not conventionally accepted.
Understood.
You know, the IgE and the RAS testing is pretty much a gold standard for all of this, but there are some fascinating labs out there in terms of response testing and whether or not there is actual degranulation that occurs in response to that, and I think that's going to be the next generation of food allergy testing, but it's still in its infancy right now. But the labs that are out there have amazing molecular profiles with various varying levels of sensitivity. So, and that's what we need to start really looking into, which one has the most efficacy. So depending on who you speak to, what their background is, what their training is, they're going to have a different appreciation for some of these tests.
Yeah.
So it's kind of important to know who your audience is and who your, you know, captain is driving that ship clinically, so to speak, what their comfort level is and which testing has the most merit. So now with that being said, in regards to food allergy testing, what has the most efficacy, I can't endorse any specific brands or companies, but I could say that it's very important component into the health equation in identifying whether or not somebody is reactive to these foods.
And classically, you could do the test. You don't have to split and send to three different labs. We have a lab that we've compared to the other standards. We think it's fairly reliable. The cost point's about the tenth of the cost of some tests. But the point is, with the FIT test, food inflammatory test, we're happy with it. There's a leaky gut test that they can do backing it up. And more importantly, so you get a report, and the report says you're compatible with all these foods, but you're not compatible, depending on the level of severity, a 1, 2, or 3, 3 being the most severe, 1 being the least, but with 0 being not. So I create a plan for them. I say, look, why don't you focus, because it's in the category of fresh fruits and vegetables and whole food, on these particular foods. Why don't you, for now, because we know those foods have other problems with them, potentially cholesterol issues, they don't have enough fiber, they don't have enough phytochemicals, enzymes, they may have some nutrient density, but I'm concerned about the toxicity for your particular level and this particular client's level of high cholesterol, LDL. And I would say, now why don't we test this out? Why don't we just do a full-on food elimination, right?
Yeah.
For 30 days,
right on.
Go off dairy yeah. product. Mm-hmm. For 30 days, go off wheat. It shows you have a reaction. And for 30 days, of all things, you're allergic yeah. to garlic. Garlic? Yeah. How could that be? Yeah. Tomato paste. I never know, but I look at the test and I go, let's just do it. And I can't tell you how many people have come back to me and go, oh my gosh, I would have never known. Because
yeah.
usually, if you talk about an IgG, Dr. Dan Danatilli talks about, look, you could consume milk that moment, unlike an IgE test, where if you ate pineapple and your mouth flares up, you go, oh, I know I'm allergic to it. Dairy products really subtle, because you drink it, it goes down smoothly, you feel good. And then a week later, the yogurt or the dairy or the cheese is causing a massive food inflammatory
reaction
to the
yeah.
white blood cells. And they're eating up the joints or releasing massive amount of lysosomes, the most powerful digestive enzymes, and you've triggered autoimmune disease.
Yeah.
So now you take them off that food. Medical journal Lancet, very prestigious journal,
yeah.
took people off complete dairy product, complete series of the most 10 most common, if you will, compatible issues. And I shouldn't call them allergens, because allergens are more IgE driven. They're more food compatibility issues. So you took them off the foods, and guess what? The arthritis goes away in 30 days. No pain, no stiffness.
Yeah.
Add a teaspoon of dairy, yeah. the amount yeah. you put in a coffee,
yeah.
and wham, the pain's back. The white cells go yeah. crazy. Everything happens. And I tell people, this is not something that you could ignore. This is so easy
yeah.
from detective work to prove. So if you don't trust the test and it's not, you know, standard of medicine care, but you go, well, wait a minute, it helped me at least trace
yes.
what's going on,
correct.
Right?
I agree with you 110%. Again, it's a matter of what's in your domain of practice and wheelhouse of appreciation. I also think that, you know, just scaling back first and looking at, you just mentioned a bunch of words, IG this, IG that, and all sorts of stuff.
Yeah,
and
please
understanding,
define and help us with that.
You know, there's five main immunoglobulins, right?
Okay.
And they all have a different role and purpose within the system and mediate different response and reactions. So just acknowledging that, you know, and I think some of the main players for this is gonna be, you know, IgG, which is more of a chronic exposure to
yes.
a specific allergen.
Continuous
right?
chronic, yes.
Yeah, exactly. And then IgM, which is more acute onset, like
yes.
say you were just recently exposed to that. IgA, which mm-hmm. deals with a lot of the body secretions, and actually there's a genomic component to that in regards to Lewis A, Lewis B, and what's called a secretor status or a FUT2. All those things influence whether or not you're secreting the appropriate amount of IgA into the body's surfaces, and offers that additional layer of protection in your mucous membranes, which is exposed areas. So from I would love to teach a course on immunology in regards to,
right now we're
you know,
just talking a little
you know,
bit about it, giving the tip of
how
the iceberg,
it,
right?
how it kind of begins, right, mm-hmm. and where it all starts. And these, actually, they're different levels of epitope binding and mm-hmm. surface area for which they could bind and have more affinity to these antigens, right? And sometimes they don't bind completely, and they have what's called haptens.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an incomplete antigen. So it doesn't form this full complex. So there's this wider array of testing and antigens and antibodies and complexes and everything else, and then IgE being more of an acute mast cell degranulation and leading to massive degranulation, and it's involved with a lot of atopic conditions, and there are various drugs that bind to those epitopes from a conventional model as well, which are, I think, great drugs that are needed to acutely manage a symptom. But while you're doing the investigative work on the mm-hmm. back end to find out what's mediating that process. So knowing when to use conventional drugs with, you know, some of the nutritional interventions, functional medicine interventions, and so forth. So that's the kind of practice that I am building and using. So circling back now to, I think, the autoimmune disease.
Right.
That's fun. The Institute for Functional Medicine just recently had a conference in Hollywood, Florida, where mm-hmm. I ran into you
yeah.
at the A4M conference a few weeks before that.
Yeah.
But the IFM conference this year was all, the annual conference was all based on autoimmune disease.
Yeah.
And I mean, there are so many different hypotheses out there in regards to what's mediating and contributing to this, with good evidence supporting some of these arguments. For example, the sterile hypothesis.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, are you familiar with that?
No, go ahead.
So with the sterile hypothesis, you know, we're now seeing a rise in autoimmunity, and it's because a lot of people are living in these isolated bubbles of hand sanitizers, decreased microbial diversity, and they're not actually
having... They're using too many, sterile products. Antibiotic or whatever, or just things that remove all the bacteria in their hands. And your hands need, and your skin, your hair.
And there's a lot of people now advocating for the use of helminth therapies, where they're actually consuming little parasitic forms to help stimulate the immune system. I think, I mean, that's some crazy stuff. However, you know, that people are getting really good results in regards to whether or not, with their autoimmune patients. And I think, you know, what's a postulated mechanism? I think it's diversion. You're distracting the immune system from self and saying, oh shit, we got something else. You know, we need to go and attack that guy versus and divert its attention, you know, from self tissue.
Right.
So, and we were having this discussion back beforehand with looking at the environmental factors that are contributing to this as well. So, I mean, we're living in a toxic world. There's tons of chemicals everywhere, flame retardants, all sorts of crazy stuff,
GMOs.
Heavy metal. And it's just, I mean, name it, you guys know about it. So just grouping things into that environmental medical context in regards to toxic burden and bioaccumulation, which ties into genomics, your ability to biotransform and detox and metabolize the stuff out of your system, there's multiple levels to this. And if we're inundated with these different environmental exposures and your body is also inundated with the burden of it, and you're can't eliminate it because you're not exercising, you're not drinking enough water, you're not doing things, you're taking drugs that are inhibiting those cytochrome P450s that prevent it from metabolizing that into whatever. It's this toxic soup, right?
Yep.
And how do we facilitate and minimize that bioaccumulation? Because as what's taught in conventional pathophysiology, but not really explained well, is that what you become what you can't detoxify and eliminate, right? And if you speak to a toxicologist, they're gonna be like, oh, that's not true. You're eliminating everything and this, that, and the other, which I don't even want to waste my time discussing that, but the reality is you are what you can't eliminate, right?
Yep,
and you start bioaccumulating things. And once you start bioaccumulating things, it leads to a deposition, right?
Yep.
So inflammation and then a deposition. Dr. Rekowig, who proposed a homotoxicology model for of medicine, I would say a more integrative approach at looking at pathophysiology or the disease processes and how we get to cancer or autoimmune disease, basically said there's a biological threshold. And once you cross over that biological threshold due to accumulation of these biotoxins into the system, you're now going to be stuck with autoimmune or cancer. And I kind of subscribe to that model because we live in a toxic world. You know, I mean, the amount of just chemicals that we're exposed to before we leave in the morning to go to work is like in the hundreds, potentially thousands if you're a female, with the different beauty products and whatnot. And then not to mention, you know, all sorts of stuff. That's a whole nother lecture right there.
Right.
So
well,
where do we
have the book Acting Be Gone for Good with Dr. Sonia Banisel Badarisi, and she talks about, you know, as a board certified dermatologist, you know, the skin is the major excretion organ.
Yeah.
What are you doing to allow that excretion? And she talks about what we're talking about, lifestyle medicine.
You've got
to look at that higher level, because you can't just identify it and knock it out with an antibiotic or just, you know, take some external cream and figure that the acne. Acne's there for a reason. What are we doing about that?
It's your body
right?
manifesting it, you know, what's going on.
And hormonally, too.
Hormonally, digestively, all sorts of different things mediate the clarity of skin, stress levels, all sorts of things.
Endocrine disruptors,
estrogen
dominance.
Yeah,
which we've created this whole thing with DIM, dimethylmethane, indole-3-carbinol, turmeric. When you go down the list of nutraceutical ingredients, and we see the before after improvements in 24-hour urine tests 30 to 60 days later, and you start seeing the skin improving, and you say, like, wow, there's something to this.
Absolutely.
And you can't ignore it. Then you take them off the supplement. Guess what? The condition comes back.
Yeah.
Put them back on it. It goes away. What do you think's going on there?
Yeah.
We're getting improvements, and you could call it manipulation, but you're really moving the hormones to their proper pathways. You've got
Correct.
to understand that hormones are not static. adipocytic. Pregnenolone doesn't stay as pregnenolone. Cortisol, DHA. There's multiple metabolites. In 24 urine, we're looking at 38 different metabolites. Most doctors look at maybe with estrogen, they look at maybe 3E1, E2, E3, estradiol, estriol, estrone. They don't look at 16 alpha hydroxyestrone.
2,4,16,
yeah. Close to, yeah. I mean, there's literally by count 10 metabolites we look at in the 24-hour urine. And then even in the androgens, there's multiple metabolites,
yeah.
DHT, in progesterone, and its relationship to not just estrogen, but its cortisol pathway.
Oh, yeah. Alpha, beta, and how that affects brain, mood, and behavior, sleep, and everything.
And then that gets back to the gut.
Yeah,
and
it does.
Endocrine
it does.
Disruptors. So
you just basically describe systems biology.
Yes.
Everything right now, the way medicine is constructed, is that we're all operating in individual silos. The nephrologist is only dealing with the nephrology and managing
kidneys.
Certain things, right? The gastroenterologist is doing their colonoscopies, endoscopies, and doing their little things.
Right.
You know, the neurologist is doing their things in regards to, you know, stroke management or whatever it might be. Cardiologist is looking at his individual silo, and the electrophysiologist is looking at very specific, component of the cardiovascular activity, and they all have their role.
Oncology
is doing their thing. Immunologists are doing. Allergists are doing their things. Pediatricians are doing their things. And it's super interesting because I'm a generalist. I'm a family trained physician, I'm kind of like a jack of all trades, master of none. But you know, we mediate the communication amongst these subspecialists, so that we could be the one that manages and kind of dictates, you know, where to go from here, and we're the scorekeeper of what's going on, so to speak. And that's why I pursued family medicine, is because I appreciate that continuity of care, and we're not just dumping somebody off to a subspecialist for them to get whatever they need, but we should be the ones managing the big picture.
Absolutely.
And with that being said, the way medicine's constructed right now, everybody has their role and their purpose and their place in acute care management. Where conventional medicine has kind of fallen off of and not doing so well is the management of chronic disease.
They've totally failed. I mean,
so and
missed
with
the point.
Yeah, and I think what's missing in our medical school educational curriculum right now is this concept of systems biology. I think, you know, historically, medical schools were taught in the subject based. Mm-hmm. So we took a histo class, we took a biochem class, we took a pharm class, we took a anatomy physiology class, and we took all these individual coursework. But now, actually, the newer medical school programs are now looking at things in regards to, all right, we're doing neuro this week, we're doing palm this week, we're doing cards this week, nephro, and so forth, more of a systems biology. So we're starting to see a trend towards that in the medical school curriculum. I'm out here right now. We're in Costa Mesa, California.
Yeah, from UCI,
I'm here right now. I spent some time at University of California, Irvine, doing some time with their integrative medicine department, and they're actually in the process of restructuring their medical school to be centralized around integrative medicine, which
huge.
Is actually going to be revolutionary, I think, moving forward in regards to how things are taught and disseminated, because right now we're still in this very reactionary mode. Oh, as soon as you get sick, we got a drug for you, pill for ill, and a crazy acute heroic intervention to save your life. How about we prevent you from getting there?
Yeah.
Right? And what is that process? And I think that's where systems biology, functional medicine, integrative therapies are going to be a part of this big picture of care, and is a model that I see moving forward for the future of healthcare. I know a lot of people are going to criticize me and disagree. Don't care. I mean, when it comes down to it, look at the science, you know? Like when it comes down to the fundamentals, what we call evidence-based medicine right now is really not evidence-based. And if you were to talk to Jeffrey Bland, the founder of the IFM, he will make some very amazing arguments towards that. And I think, especially in the era of precision medicine where we are today, you know, we have amazing diagnostic tools to individualized therapies. And right now, precision medicine is being heavily used in the field of oncology, but I think translating that into primary preventative care is going to be very important.
Right.
And precision medicine is going to deal now with looking at these additional testing, right? But also appreciating your genomic blueprint. from a pharmacogenomic, nutrigenomic, and microbial genomic perspective. And once we understand your individual components, we could then now curtail this information and curate individualized protocols based upon what's going on. Whether it's looking at the blood from a qualitative perspective, running a CBC or additional blood work and get a quantitative value of what's going on, and merging this information with additional testing to identify what's really going on, what are the drivers of this? And circling back to the fundamental principles to all this stuff, oxidation, inflammation, mediating all of this stuff, and quenching those chronic inflammatory and oxidative processes and maintaining a delicate balance and homeostasis is what's
fundamental. I'm glad you bring that up. And also, you know, from a clinical standpoint, in this particular client, looking at the fact that what additional tests, ANA, what's the ANA going to tell us about his potential autoimmune and sed rate and things related to, you know, why does he have this pain in his hands and it's chronic and getting worse? And you look at the blood morphology and you can see some ovalocytes and you can point those out with the little cursor there. And look at how those white blood cells are highly active, almost too active. You know, medicinal mushrooms tend to calm down overactive white blood cells. If they're too underactive, they're an adaptogen, they tend to enhance. So it might be good for this gentleman to go through a whole protocol of, we've assembled some products that have medicinal mushrooms all together. And what would that be, you know, what would be the dose? What would be the process? The beauty of observational microscopy, we can intervene quickly and show a quick smear and show immediately, is it helping or not? Right. And this is my experience for 40 years, because I have to tell you, early days, I was like opposed to supplementation. I thought, look, everything comes from your foods. Yeah. Don't worry about it. And I worked with Nathan Pritikin. That was his mantra. He'd always say, you know, you can get it all from your foods. And then over a 40-year period, looking at blood morphology, looking at the background of the blood, looking at the shape and morphology, and realizing that those ovalocytes, why are the cell walls collapsing? This gentleman needs B12. He needs a highly absorbable B12, maybe a highly absorbable form of folic acid, not just from plants, folocene, but 5-methyltetrahydrofolate.
Yeah.
Jeffrey Bland would be the first to say, absolutely, right?
So,
and methylcobalamin. So, and look at those patches of what we would call normally candida fungal forms, but it's actually anaerobic fermentative bodies, right? But you know, this is not up for debate. It's there. We're seeing it.
Right on. Right. And you know, again, Jeffrey Bland is somebody who I hold dear in my heart. I think he's one of the revolutionary or visionary leaders of our times today.
He's, by the way, in our online course. I'm good friends with him. He knew Lester Morrison, who was the one who kind of spawned and motivated Nathan Pritikin to get into the whole thing of lifestyle medicine, started the Pritikin Longevity Center. And it was Jeffrey Bland watching that early development of, wow, maybe there's something to this whole foods eating, because he had some, you know, issues in his own family that he had to deal with, right?
Yeah. And the thing with Dr. Bland is also, you know, he, not only is he the founder of the Institute for Functional Medicine, you know, an organization who I've studied with, and I'm actually flying out to Portland tonight to go and train with tomorrow, but he's also the founder of the Personalized Lifestyle Medical Institute, PLMI, who puts together these amazing conferences every year with visionary leaders in the field, pushing the envelope forward towards whatever you want to call it, functional, precision, I don't care, but it's good medicine.
Yes.
And it's individualized medicine with the intent and purpose of patient care and not pharmaceutical interests. And that's what I really appreciate about Dr. Bland. But circling back to...
Yeah, tell me a little more about this. What other tests might we want to do using this as an observational starting point, knowing that he has okay triglycerides, good blood sugar level, but he's got some issues with overactive white blood cells.
Think about where most of the white blood cells are congregated in our system. They're hanging out in lymph tissue, right?
Yes.
And that's where they get programmed, right? Where do you have the highest aggregation of lymph nodes? In the gut. So going back and circling around the gut, the Peyer's patches and all that good stuff, I would start there. You know, personally, I would just see, I would run additional testing to figure out if there's...
What test?
I have no financial association or affiliation with these companies, but I would run a Genova GIFX to see what's going on, because it's going to give you whether or not there is a...
Genova Labs, Florida, North Carolina.
Correct. Mm-hmm. And they have a really great profile where they're looking at the
Is it a stool sample?
Three-day stool sample, where you're able to... So if you were to get into stool testing to begin with, right? So I've actually had to look at, you know... stool samples and diagnose different parasites. And
do you look under a microscope, or how do you
microscopically? Oh, nice. Yeah, it's called OMP times three, right? So ovum parasite, you want three different samples throughout the day, because you know you have a nice large digestive system, and some people poop more than others, and there's different microbial forms that'll be captured during the transient, you know, elimination of fecal matter throughout the digestive tract, and there's different parts of the intestine that pick up different things. That's it. So OMP times three is a baseline level of stool testing in which you're looking for ovum and parasites. But now, in today's molecular age, there are different tests and companies out there. I really like the Genova Labs because they run additional biomarkers that look at calprotectin, fecal calprotectin, which is going to tell you whether or not there's neutrophils some of these cells aggregating in the tissues there and causing that inflammatory response.
Yeah,
absolutely. Mm-hmm. So, and then it's also going to pick up on different biomarkers that are associated with dysbiosis, which is fancy words for saying imbalanced gut flora, right?
Yep.
And, you know, there are different companies out there doing different molecular testing, like, for example, Ubiome or Viome. There are different companies that are looking at who's there, what they're doing, and their different metabolomics. And I think that's pretty cool and fascinating as well. So I would start with looking at the gut. You know, in any integrative or functional thing, you always start with the gut. But now what we're doing is, I think this is a tool. Yeah. And today, July 11th, 2018, I think we're standing on so much information. And this information that we have available to us today and the principles of functional integrative medicine and everything else tell you to always start with the gut, right? And now we have a mechanism behind this.
Yes.
And why we're seeing rod-shaped bacteria in the blood.
Yes.
Why we're seeing candida in the blood. Why we're seeing all this stuff. Because of this biological process.
So true.
You know, so has anybody taught you that? No? Right here, buddy. So this is years and years of like me accumulating years and years of you accumulating this information and now translating it to what we're seeing here.
Right.
Because, you know, some people are going to, you know, say, oh, this isn't a viable technique. And I do agree. There are a lot of variables that you need to take into account for and should be performed in a controlled environment.
Correct.
And we could get into some of the other stuff behind the scenes.
Well, that's what we do in this online course.
Of course.
We train in the correct procedure, collection of the blood sample, you know, what, and take a history on the client, you know, where are they at, what are they eating, what's their lifestyle, how does that tie on, are they using antibiotics or not? I mean, there's a lot of things that you need to know, right?
Oh, man, and we had that conversation about antibiotics, the disruptors, the environmental factors, the food allergens, and how that's mediating everything. So, but it all starts with, you know, also just looking at who the patient is, where they're at, and what they're doing, right?
Right.
Painting that baseline in the IFM model, they have what they call the functional medicine matrix. They have a timeline. And they have a few other things that influence your, you know, capturing this data and establishing your baseline of health, where you're at right now, and using these different tools and biomarkers to see what's mediating this process. And then we're going to try to get you remediated on a personalized protocol and get you back to health. So with all that stuff being said, man, I think that
let's switch to the dry blood, by the way.
Cool.
Oh, you had something more to comment?
No,
switch over. Let's just take the slide off here. We'll just put it on the stage and switch over to a 4X, 40X, go to A.
There we go.
And we should be able to just bring the slide over forward. There we go. And we might have to turn the light down. That's not catching the slide as well as it should. Okay. Get a little focus on that puppy. Yeah, so now dry blood is very, we'll say, controversial. We look at a sample like this, this portion, you'd say, oh, the guy probably exercises consistently. I happen to know he does. So you get the fibrin that holds the blood cells together, but we see this white patch. Dr. Bradford, who had studied the work of Heaton and Lagarde, again, the physicians of President Eisenhower, looked at thousands of samples and said, there's some pattern here.
Yeah.
When people had certain chronic conditions, it showed this kind of representation. And so polymerized proteins, protein puddles, as he called it, is not empty space. It's, he believed, some breakdown of tissue somewhere in the body, and that also, he went further, kind of like iridology, where he said from embryology, there's this central cell, and they start off in the middle, and they emanate outward. So he theorized, and it was believed, and probably possible, and again, theory, observation, that the center of the body, wherever these holes accumulate, that you'd ask, is there some gut problems? Is there some issues in the peripheral? Is it the arms, the hands? Is in women, breast tissue or brain? So where is the location of the dominant amount of oxidative stress free radical damage? What's really strange, and I, it's almost like unexplainable, it's almost like a fingerprint. A fingerprint always comes out the same way. When I get a drop of blood like this and I find a pattern of oxidative stress, let's say I'll draw a circle and there's a bunch of holes up here, each sample, every time I take a sample, and we take four drops, one, two, three, four, because we want to unmask the bigger drop, smaller sample, smaller sample, smaller. When you get to smaller, we believe you can then see allergens or adrenal stress, because in the thicker drop, it's filled in the blood and you can't see some underlying structures. But going back to where the protein, polymerized protein, or what they call reactive oxygen toxic species, by the way, grab that book by Bradford. And that book shows us, this is one of the original textbooks that, you know, he wrote, Oxidology. And you've read it as well. You have the book. Pretty amazing textbook, right?
It is.
And interesting theories.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I was fortunate enough to meet Dr. Robert Bradford before he passed away.
Yes. And I studied with him directly.
Yeah, you know, I was able to catch him and discuss various things. And, you know, one of the things that he left, he was working on before his passing, was actually looking at... the potential for what he was describing as Lyme, parasitized Lyme disease in white blood cells. And I actually, was fortunate enough to spend some time with him. He trained me on a few additional things. It was super fascinating to see. So going back, though, to these polymerized protein puddles that he described at PPPs.
Which is these white holes. You're looking
white
at
holes.
Four, one, two, three, four in the center of the sample, which denotes, is there something going on with this guy's gut? Is there some kind of a possible cancer going on? You can't diagnose cancer, but what is it, right?
So it's interesting because this is not a technique that I openly endorse and recommend in practice. However, I do know a good amount of people that are using this technique and swear by it and have amazing clinical correlations with their patient population and specific disease diagnoses and its correlations to the manifestations that's being observed under dry blood cell microscopy here. So with that being said, you know, there is a theory, the embryological theory, mesoectoderm, and how it radiates out in its somatic representation.
Yes.
And how there's different correlations of different findings and so forth. For me, based upon that philosophy and training, you are correct in regards to what they're trying to identify, in regards to manifest imbalances within different tissues and different parts of the body.
Right.
Again, this isn't a technique that I endorse specifically. I find it really fascinating and interesting.
Right.
Does it have some clinical utility? I can't say specifically because, again, this is not a conventionally accepted technique. Mm-hmm. However, I do believe there is some merit to it and that, you know, we could see it. You know,
by
why
the way,
is
where these holes are, where we before as it was drying, we saw these black rings. We both said, oh, we're told that's heavy metals. What do? You send it off because you trust, you don't can't trust just the observation.
Yep.
You do a hair analysis. Don't just trust hair. You do a blood and a urine. If all three samples or one of the three come back with an identifiable heavy metal at a higher concentration. I mean, I've worked with metal workers and I look at their blood, big black rings, and I'm like, holy Christ, what is that?
Yeah.
And I send it off, sure enough, high levels, mercury, cadmium, arsenic, I mean, you name it. I mean, you know, and you don't know when you see the ring what heavy metal it is, and is it really the sign? So, you know.
Clinically correlating it to the MSQ or multiple system questionnaire and correlating it to the live blood that we just observed, we both know that Candida feeds off mercury. Right.
Wow, good
and,
point.
There was a signs of anaerobic yeast fermentation bodies that we observed in the previous sample, the live blood sample.
Correct.
And correlating this now to the dry blood, you know, and you're postulating that there might be a heavy metal burden. Well, that's another clinical correlate right there.
Right.
I mean, we could be, is there amalgam in this picture, you know?
Right, does he have amalgam fillings, right?
You know, is there something else that is causing this, is there occupational exposure?
You know,
what line of work does this person do? So again, getting a really
good— water purified?
Exactly.
Where's the food source?
Yeah.
Is there pesticides in the foods? You know, I mean, the
exactly.
list, but at least it gets you going in the right direction.
Exactly,
right?
And it's opening up that topic of discussion.
And how often does he do far infrared spa
exactly.
as opposed to regular spa?
Yeah.
And I have a spa facility here, so I'm gonna dump a minute. We're gonna see if we can remove the heavy metals. So that being said, we need to change tapes or?
It's just the memory card's about to fill up.
Okay, good. So in summary, when we look at dry blood morphology, since this isn't particularly your area of appreciation, yet you respect the fact that we might be seeing certain things that would at least lead us to the next level. For example, when we look at hypercalcemia, I'm seeing the beginning. See how those streaks?
Yeah, yeah.
If you see
radial
these streaks,
spokes, yeah.
What's going on? Is that the pituitary? Is there something? Is a person using losing too much calcium?
Perineoplastic process. There's different things that could be
right.
said about that. Yeah.
And then, did he have intestinal toxins? The beginnings of, you know, is there adrenal stress? The smaller holes and allergies. So what we would then cross reference, do a FIT test, food inflammatory test.
Yeah.
We would check the gut, like you mentioned. And why are these larger holes concentrated in the center? So would we run, thermography, check out, you know, what's his body radiating? Is there,
sure.
is there estrogen dominance? Is there congestions going on? Is there blockages? Is there the right heat ratio? Would you do a particular, an MRI as opposed to a coronary calcium score? Because his high LDL cholesterol, we'll send him up the street for $125, see if there's coronary. I had a good friend, a doctor friend, and I kept telling him, this is not good. Your levels are not good. And sure enough, he had the widowmaker, complete blockage. He was still alive because of collateral circulation. But had he not been told by me, you better get this checked, he could be a walking dead guy.
No, I agree with everything you just said. And actually, if you were to look at down the street here in San Diego with Craig Venter and his organization, the Human Longevity Center and Inc. They have what they call the Health Nucleus Test Panel, which they actually are doing everything you just said in regards to coronary calcium scores.
Yep.
They're doing full body MRIs. They're doing tons of imaging, complete genomic sequencing, exonal and introns as well. And they're doing a la carte additional microbiome testing and everything else. I think that's our new baseline in regards to understanding your physiologic age. There are other tests that you could do to look at the arterial stiffness and things like that.
Yes,
but
yes.
just identifying this stuff is going to be very important.
Well, the number one killer is heart disease and stroke
is,
and peripheral vascular disease,
right? And also looking at the MESA study, the multiple ethnic study of atherosclerosis, which is our modern day Framingham study. And if you, for those that don't know, the Framingham study is the largest, oldest cardiovascular disease research publication that's been going on and study that's been going on for many years.
Framingham, Massachusetts, William Castelli, which Pritikin, you know, knew. And I mean, this all goes back, you tie this all in. So in summary, I did want to mention, and maybe this segment doesn't have all the details about what supplements. I've been very generic. Molecular hydrogen, for example, we're now starting to investigate, will that help reduce oxidative stress? How much free radical damage is necessary in the body? Do you want a selective antioxidant and not just wipe it out with a high auric value?
Exactly.
You know, don't just take random a bunch of free antioxidants, because that may not be in your best interest. Your body might be mounting a defense against cancer, or it might be the chemo agents or something that's causing more oxidative stress. So we look at these things, and this is my experience 40 years, your experience of 20 plus years and your MD, and what are we doing then to piece this together? And that's what this online course is about, is like, okay, where do we start? Now we know the gut's critical. We look at an observational tool. We don't depend on it by itself, but we then, you know, translate. We can start helping the client to look at this. This is what we found. This is not normal. This is a condition that relates to your symptomology.
Correct.
But now let's get back, and for the further segments, we're going to get into the corrective nature of what we got to do.
Exactly.
Do you buy into using a little bit of silver, colloidal silver, or
love
something?
It.
Yeah, okay, so it's good.
Love
for
it.
Some of
biofilms and everything.
The harmful bacterial forms.
Yep.
Very good.
Yeah.
And let's jump over into like the Jeffrey Bland, some of the nutraceuticals. You don't have to name product names, not even ours. But let's just talk about some of them, because I know my main online guy's going, you got to finish this course. You got to add. That's what's missing.
Yeah. So okay. I think so it's going to be very individualized.
Open to that right now.
Yeah.
We're rolling, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah. So individualize, and let's take this particular client. Would we jump into, you know, since we did see some possible candidal, you've heard of caprylic acid to maybe target that potential fermented body formation, right? Is it possible that caprylic acid, some people call it yeast gar, they use different names for it, but we use it in a particular product which is mixed with adrenals and ashwagandha.
What kind of adrenals?
We use an adrenal
glandular
cortex from New Zealand and highly purified. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you know, it just depends on the individual and what they're calling for. With this guy, you know, again, I would not use this to guide therapy or treatment.
Correct.
Because this is a non-diagnostic
right.
tool.
Good point.
Right? This is just meant for
what's
us to observe.
Next test,
yeah, what's
right?
the next test? I would move on with further testing.
Correct.
And once I achieve those further testings, both serological, blood, urine, saliva, stool, mm-hmm. I would figure out what's going on quantitatively, metabolically, and take it from there and try to individualize their protocol.
Great point.
Using a therapeutic order. And that therapeutic order is, you know, going back to that 3 or 4 or 5 hour approach, depending on who you speak to in regards to removing, repairing, reinoculating, okay. And all that good stuff of the gut, right?
Right.
So, and that will come with identifying specific problem foods, specific dysbiotic microorganisms, and reinoculating with healthy probiotics and repairing the gut if there's
I'm
a leaky gut.
I'm glad you brought
the
probiotics.
The
prebiotics,
glutamine.
Probiotics,
yeah,
do you
yeah.
have a preference of a certain way they're cultured? We hear different things about probiotics in the refrigerated section.
Oh,
maybe
yeah,
it's
dude.
Hard to get
yeah.
them better and concentrations reasonable. Is it, you know, some of these name brands may not be all they're purported to.
Yeah.
Because when they measure them after, is the measurement present?
So it's, you know, Consumer Labs is a really good resource to see what's meeting label claims in regards
oh, nice.
To,
okay.
you know, quality and assurance that there's no hidden garbage that or toxic tagalongs or whatever it is within the nutraceutical product. Again, this is a non-FDA regulated industry,
yep.
and you have to be careful with what products you're using, whether they meet label claims, whether there are any contaminants or anything like that. So it's, you know,
right.
you have to be, as a physician, I have to be very careful with what products I endorse and what supplements I endorse because, again, it's you're deviating now slightly from the standard of care.
As by the way, you're right on because we utilize a laboratory that also produces pharmaceuticals, so they follow a standard for nutraceuticals.
Yeah, GMP.
Good yeah. manufacturing practices, so they do bacteria studies, they do heavy metal studies, make sure the supplements are pure of any
yeah,
toxins and chemicals.
Good.
And more importantly, if they say there's 50 milligrams or 100 milligrams of dimethylmethane, they do an acceleration study over the course of a year or two. They see, okay, the 100 milligrams after a year, is it still at 100? Is it 95? Then we better start at 105
yeah.
and check, make sure
yeah.
it's still at 100. So
the half-life, yeah,
yeah.
making
so,
sure
so
it's still there.
So it's really
yeah.
important, and most labs don't even come close yeah. to those standards.
Wonderful.
We do because it's my reputation on the line,
sure,
and
sure.
since doctors tend to like our products and
yeah.
utilize them, and we have a whole brand now for doctors, it's like, it's good because early on, you know, all the other competitors were selling cheap products at cheap price, selling them off, but we call it window dust.
Yeah.
There's products out there that, what you just said, they don't meet label claim.
Yeah.
If it says the ingredients there, it may not be there. And in most cases, according to FDA studies, warnings, there was, I think, 400 laboratories looked at, and 370 got warnings saying they did not meet label claim. It was that bad. It was
yeah.
like only a small percent that
wow.
met. So we searched the country, the world, and said, what is the best standard, and how do we go about preserving and protecting our clients? Because if I'm going to take the products, and my family's going to take the products, and you're going to take the products, you want to know you're getting, and that's why some of these products may not work. Efficacious, you're going, well, I took that product. I took the particular DM,
yeah.
or I took the wait a minute, was it absorbable? Do you understand delivery systems,
exactly,
right?
Liposomal, lipid, the bioperin, and all that good stuff.
A
yeah.
whole series.
Yeah.
Go ahead, elaborate on that. What is it you're understanding with what you've learned from Jeffrey Bland and other mentors? How important is this field, nutraceuticals, and do you think it's going to continue to grow under the right guidance?
I think so. I think, you know, every day we're moving in the right direction. There was a recent publication that came out a year or two ago that actually looked at a lot of your commercial lines, Walmart, GNC, mm-hmm. Vitamin Shop, Walgreens, mm-hmm. and a few others, and they basically found out that, you know, the products that they were packaging was not, one, meeting label claims, and they weren't the actual product or ingredient that was listed.
Wow.
So, yeah. I mean, I think for echinacea, there was like ragweed or something like that. Oh, and that's where you need to be very careful with, you know, who and what you're using. And unfortunately, I don't trust those, a lot of those commercial lines.
Right.
I trust physician grade lines and products.
Yes.
Additionally, there's some, I also trust Whole Foods Market. I'm just going to say that.
Okay.
I really trust, you know, that's how I got into all this stuff.
Oh, yeah.
When I was like 16 years old, I'm like juicing beets and like, you know, vegetarian and all this stuff, wrestling and jujitsu and all that stuff, you know, and that's where I got my initial training from. You know, I was meeting Udo Erasmus. I was meeting Michael Murray from Natural Factors, you know.
And Michael.
Yeah, you know, these
out
great
of Canada,
guys.
Right,
yeah,
Michael.
Yeah, Mike. And, you know, meeting these guys are coming and they're doing their product training for us and educating us about the importance of, you know, good manufacturing processes and everything else. And so that's kind of where I launched and started with this whole industry, you know, a good amount of time ago. And throughout this process, I think watching the evolution of the industry as a whole, I'm from originally South Florida and have the, you know, luxury of going to Life Extensions periodically for blood work.
Bill
and
Falloon.
Yeah, Bill Falloon. And, you know, which is an amazing, I think, resource and publication for this industry of nutraceuticals and demonstrating evidence-based and guided therapeutic interventions. And their products are pretty phenomenal as well.
Yeah.
I'm not endorsing them.
No,
I'm just saying,
And Bill and I talk a lot, shop behind closed doors, and we talk about, you know, what's the efficacy of this? Where was the study on this? And you got to bring it back full circle, because if you have something that you're representing that clients are buying, you want to make sure that they're going to get results. And so I always look at who's the gold standard and how can we be better? And
exactly.
That's what I'm looking at.
And I thank you for doing that, because I think we need more people like you that are actually taking that initiative to seek out the best quality ingredients and supplements and products and putting together interesting formulas that I think could help anybody. Is there a magic bullet? No. There will never be a magic bullet. There is no magic bullet. Is there a single cure for cancer? No, there isn't.
No.
I'm sorry. It's not there. The care
it's complex.
Is multimodal. And all I could say is that, you know, there are a lot of things going on right now. There are, you know, circling back to that statement, you know, cure for cancer, there are specific precision therapies, especially like with specific cancers like CML, where there actually is a very good therapeutic agent.
CML being?
A chronic myelogenous leukemia.
Yes.
Certain forms of Hodgkin's
very
lymphoma. And again, going back and circling back to this era of precision medicine, we're now able to identify specific targeted therapies and interventions. But that's a totally different, you know, discussion, a totally different realm of patients and everything else. Right now, we're talking about wellness. We're talking about enhanced performance and also treating chronic disease conditions and mitigating some of the different biological processes that are influencing that disease progression. So diabetes, heart disease, cardiometabolic syndrome as a whole, hypertension or high blood pressure, all these things are influencing, are very predominant in our culture right now, and the prevalence is super high. It's all what I deal with day in and day out as a primary care physician. So, you know, if we were to start deconstructing each individual and the pathophysiological process that led them to being a diabetic, it's going to be different. You know, everybody's disease is different. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the same disease on ICD-10, that A1C is creeping up, but how we got there is different.
Yeah.
And
well, Dr. Anil, when you're looking at this situation, you know, you can't help but think about, you know, what's the field look like with the use of stem cells? Because you mentioned leukemia, and one of the early solutions to leukemia was first eradicate all the misformed, abnormally elevated white blood cells, because it's a cancer of the blood, essentially, and then repopulate them with healthy stem cells. And basically, you know, we look at cord blood now, we look at some unique interventions, but some people believe maybe you didn't need to eradicate the stem cells, maybe the correct trigger or the main format to introducing healthy white blood cells would trigger a reformation. So that needs to be looked at, because right now there's, you know, hesitance or a lack of awareness. Some of the practitioners I work with are saying we could do this. I like to look at the literature about certain nutrients. I created, worked with a product that actually helps with the formulators. And I looked and I said, how can we get something that releases more stem cells? Because the body produces its own stem cells when we're young.
Correct.
Can it release them? And what are those ingredients? So we put together a group of like 20 different ingredients that basically we believe target the increase. And you can measure follow-up stem cell cultures, and you can look under a microscope. It's interesting because I've been to stem cell labs. I've looked at cord blood, and I look under the microscope. If someone's selling me a vial of stem cells, I want to look, even in the research labs around the world, and you can see what stem cells look like. And if they're crenated, they're dead, and you're injecting those into people, and people are charging in Panama or different third world countries, and people are kind of falling prey to certain therapies. So I really want people to know that a lot of years of research and time. So I love observation because under the microscope at 100x, at 4,000 magnification, I can see stem cells. Is someone being delivered stem cells? And I actually have worked with people, you know, including myself, because I look, hey, I'm a candidate. Is stem cells only for injury and acute, or maybe we can use it for anti-aging? Maybe we can use it for reformation, cartilage, and bone. Dr. Shaw in Malaysia, he's doing fabulous work. He's a board-certified orthopedist out of London trained, and the guy's doing amazing work. People said, you can't resurface cartilage. Wait a minute, how do you do it? He does little drill points, and that causes the irritation. It draws the stem cells to the area, resurface cartilage. He's got 100 MRIs that I personally looked at, and we looked at the clients coming in, the elite athletes, and I said, this is worldwide amazing. Not all stem cell doctors do that. They just inject it. They hope it's going to go in. It's going to hold. What do you know about stem cells? Are you looking at this, and what's your theory about, you know, supplementation and procedures and correct cord blood versus autologous, you know,
adipocytes and so that's a very interesting question. I think we're still, you know, recovering from 8 years of, you know, oppression in regards to the Bush administration banning stem cell research in this country. And that's unfortunately why a lot of these other third world countries,
India
are,
and so forth,
in Middle America, you know, Bolivia, and Asia, they're doing all sorts of different therapies that we are still, I think, behind the times on here in the U.S., unfortunately. But circling back to also the concept of, we both trained with A4M. I'm sure you know Mark Rosenberg, integrative oncologist, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had the pleasure of going to his office a few months ago. We were hanging out. We were discussing shop about the this one oncologist. They wrote a book on him, Emmanuel Ravici, the doctor who cured cancer. And I had a very rare publication sitting on my parents' on my bookshelf at my parents' house in South Florida, and he's been looking for this book for many years. And I brought him this book, and we had an amazing discussion to his practice in West Palm Beach. Boca Raton.
Right.
And we were chatting about, you know, what he's working on right now in regards to a specific chemotherapeutic agent that's going to target the cancer stem cell. And he's actually in, I probably shouldn't be saying too much, but he announces it at his conferences that he's working with Harvard right now to develop specifically a therapeutic agent for cancer stem cells,
which is
pretty exciting.
Right, because you can develop cancer, you can use chemo radiation, shrink the tumor, but those cancer stem cells are immortal, and they're going to crop back up with a vengeance, maybe mutate and come back worse, right?
So with that being said,
cure the patient, but cure the symptom, but lose the patient, right?
True.
Yeah.
And it's very interesting to see his approach to, you know, stem cells within oncology, right? Mm-hmm. But now we could talk about regenerative medicine and the role of stem cells in sports injuries and so forth.
Yeah.
I'm glad you mentioned your friend who has before and after imaging studies.
Yes.
And demonstration of a regeneration of articular hyaline cartilage.
Yeah, Dr. Shaw out of Malaysia. Mm-hmm.
Which is brilliant. We don't have that here in the U.S.
No, we don't.
You speak to any orthopedist and they're going to say stem cells, look, you know, it's good, but the evidence is mixed. They're not showing actual regeneration of tissue specificity, but what they are appreciating is a improvement in symptomatic disturbance within the patient. So there, right now, the evidence is mixed in regards to whether or not that and hyaluronic acid for regeneration of specific articular hyaline cartilage.
Well, he uses hyaluronic acid
with it for the cofactors,
with PRP
and all that other good stuff.
PRP So, and then the local acute injury, you know, he stimulates that because it may have been a chronic injury.
Yeah.
And then he's working to re-injure it right at on. That site.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
Draw the stem cells to that area.
Yeah, that micro trauma causes the attention mm-hmm. and causes the influx into the localized tissue and everything else. I was privileged also to spend some time with the University of Miami sports medicine director, and we were having an interesting conversation right before the Orange Bowl earlier. Well, that was last year, and we were discussing what they're doing there and what results they're getting with stem cell and PRP, and they were getting amazing results. Right. But my take on stem cell therapy is this. I think there is some merit to it. There is some efficacy to it, and it's very good clinical response. Unfortunately, the U.S. is kind of behind the times right now in regards to what's being delivered
right.
And the efficacy of it, whether you're doing autologous, embryonic, or adipocyte, you know, blood or whatever.
Yeah.
There's just so many different variations to it.
I've done them all.
The pluripotent, really.
And work with different patients. The only thing I haven't done is embryo stem cells. I don't feel that's a field that we're ready to handle or even harness. But the cord blood, it hasn't taken code yet. It's helped a lot of
very naive
palsy kids.
Pluripotential.
It may be helping autistic kids. I'm seeing some pretty remarkable results in this area.
And I've spoken to many people that are using this in their clinical practice, some sending their patients overseas to Bolivia and other Middle America countries to get these therapies, you know, post-MI, dead myocardium, getting some regeneration in the heart, right? Post-stroke, degenerative hips, things like that. They're getting really good results. It's right now still, I think, in its infancy in regards to our full understanding of how it works. But, you know, if you look at the quality of life of getting a hip replacement versus going for stem cells, and you're ready on your way out.
I used to work as a physical therapist, you know.
Go with the stem, you know, try it out. Why not?
People took the rehabilitation, like you said, is so traumatic, especially in an older patient.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and so could this work, right?
Mel Gibson was on Joe Rogan's podcast the other day, and a podcast that I love listening to. I actually was fortunate enough while I was out here in California, caught Joe at the Comedy Store. It was awesome. And
I've seen him too.
Yeah, so it's great stuff. And he has a whole host of wonderful people coming onto his podcast in the clinical arena as well. And he had Mel Gibson on there speaking about his father and how he needed like a bilateral hip transplant, but he chose not to. Went to some, you know, middle America country, got IV stem cells and localized injections, and the dude's walking. No need for a hip replacement. So when you hear these anecdotal like, or just these case studies of people responding so favorably to these therapies, you have to wonder and ask, you know, there has to be something there.
It's interesting, by the way, that there's some local Californian doctors that I've worked with for a number of years, and they found like kind of an area where, so long as the patient, we don't advertise it and market it, that the patient comes in, is evaluated properly, is a candidate for, and is charted properly. I know of literally over, I think it's 6,000 cases now that have been done here locally, not having to fly to a dangerous country, deal with all that issue. And I'm a big fan of it. I mean, like I said, I personally have had treatments.
I am too.
I can't sell each individual, this is a cure-all for everyone. No way. If it's done right and correctly and under the right conditions for the right situation, then you know, be with someone who has that experience, because you hear these people out there doing fat-derived stem cells, they're injecting in the eye, caused horrible damage in some people.
Crazy.
I mean, some really dumb things have been done.
Yeah, so clinics are getting shut down.
Yeah. And they will be. Because,
yeah,
and they should
not doing good medicine. So with all that being said, you know, I think we both are, you know, students of science, and we love pursuing different coursework and everything else. You know, I've been seeing you for many years now in the circuit.
Yeah.
And I think it's, you know, the next thing that I'm looking into after, you know, A4M is the A4M fellowship in stem cell therapy is something that I'm going to be pursuing here in the near future and starting.
By the way, I was one of the first teachers on stem cells for the whole A4M going around the world and teaching about it. And I met with some of the early pioneers, and it's interesting because I pulled back from that area because it got so heated and controversial and an issue, but I kept my hand on the pulse to go, where is it going? What's the best therapies? Who's doing the best work?
Yeah.
because some people, you know, including myself, I'm no young chicken anymore. Yeah. I got to keep after it, right? Yeah. I still compete. I still lift. I compete at the level that I did when I was in my 20s. Yeah. And I attribute it because I know and I've utilized these therapies. Now, you spent some time with it. You be objective. That's fine. We're on the camera.
Yeah.
You tell me. I mean, you met a lot of practitioners.
Well, you walk the walk, man. You walk the walk. You talk the talk and walk the walk. You know, you're a living, breathing representation of what you believe in. And I truly commend you on that because, you know, you invited me to your home. We got some time together where, you know, you prepared me an amazing vegan oil-free meal, which was delicious. And, you know, made me realize that, you know, we could all fine-tune and optimize our diet to the level in which you're pursuing and endorsing. And I thank you for that. And I could truly sit here and say that I could endorse, you know, your recommendations for certain things because you're well-informed, you good intent and purpose, and, you know, you walk the walk and talk the talk, and it's awesome to see that. But just going back on to the stem cell thing, I think it's very important to see that, also circling back to this idea of a therapeutic order, okay?
Yes.
And the four R's and everything else that we discussed earlier today is very important because I think the therapeutic order should come with some discretion before jumping into stem cells.
Totally agree.
You know, you need to
prepare their body because if you've got a polluted body and you're going to go shoot it with stem cells and hormones, what are you doing?
Yeah.
I'm the first to say, let's clean up the act. Let's get the diet right. Let's get the detoxification, right?
So that your body could respond better to this therapy. So
repeat the four R's because it might have been earlier in the segment.
So it's like remove, repair, re-inoculate, and I forgot what the other R was, but there's like 4, 5, 3, whoever, it depends who you talk to.
Right.
So looking at that philosophical approach by removing those factors and repairing the damage and just trying to re-inoculate the healthy flora and the micronutrients needed, replenish the micronutrients.
Yes, is the other R.
Yeah, so, you know, it's very important, you know, so it's the fundamental pillars of cultivating health, you know? I mean, this isn't neurosurgery or anything profound. It's pretty, I think, self-evident, you know, when it comes down to it. But just preparing the body to receive the message that's being delivered, which is, you know, I'm trying to regenerate. And how do you get that person prepped for that full regenerative potential? Are you giving Myers cocktails and vitamin C, which is a very important cofactor for collagen synthesis? Are you doing
things? And not just the standard Myers cocktail, the updated version that we have that are better nutraceutical or chosen the correct vitamins, the correct 5-methyl tetrahydrofolate, the right type of methyl cobalamin,
which facilitates DNA synthesis
to a better hybrid instead of standard cheap vitamins that are just infused, right?
And one thing that we did not mention, but we're going to drop now, is MTHFR. What conversation about this stuff is if you don't mention the MTHFR?
Please talk
about it. So
methyl donors and so forth.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah,
it's huge, and I've been looking at it for a long time. What's your feeling about it?
I mean. The thing is, I think right now it's a very big marketing ploy right now, but has a lot of clinical relevance.
Yes.
At the University of Maryland where I'm training, you know, if you speak to the geneticists there and the genetic counselors, they hate the MTHFR. But when you speak to the MDs, not these mid-level practitioners, they're like, well, you know, homocysteine is a real biomarker that we need to look at, you know, which is a manifestation of MTHFR dysfunction. So that, again, for those who don't know what that is, MTHFR, there's two major variants, C677T and what is it, 1488 or whatever it is, 677, 1298 or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And looking at those two major variants and its influence on folate and B12 metabolism. And going back to the biochemistry and looking at this other stuff and clinically correlating the gene to whether or not it's being expressed biochemically with a surrogate marker of homocysteine. So if you have this MTHFR, theoretically, you'll have elevated homocysteine. Homocysteine perpetuates this pro-inflammatory oxidative vasculopathic process linked to depression. Detoxification, impaired detoxification, and just overall DNA synthesis. Because if any textbook you'll see, folate and B12 facilitate DNA synthesis.
Yes.
And with that being said, going back and making sure you're giving your body the appropriate cofactors based upon your genomic blueprint and everything else, that big milieu, that big soup bouillon of what's going on that we call a body, and giving it the appropriate cofactors needed so that we could receive the message and respond appropriately is, I think, very important. So there are a lot of like little things, you know, with all of this, a therapeutic order, and it's clinician dependent, you know.
Right.
I think, you know, with your experience and wisdom, you're positioned yourself to not only advocate for healthy eating and lifestyle, the supplements, the nutraceuticals, and all the other things. I mean, you're the herbal medicine and the stem cells. I mean, your toolkit's amazing, and you're right. Super well connected with all the leaders in the field, which is amazing. And I thank you for having me on today. You know, I feel very privileged to be sitting here.
Your contribution's huge. You know, I mean, once we met in Florida, I go, oh my gosh, I got to have you on the show. You so are advanced beyond. And what I like most about you is that, like you said, there's the specials. They know what they know. They know about a particular hormone. They know about a particular, you know, intervention. But when you start talking about all these different subjects, they're lost. It's like, oh no, I don't get it.
Yeah.
And you've been in there, because when you're looking at the cellular level, starting the observation tool, and you're looking at, you know, how do the hormones interact? Because some of the doctors get really good, for example, with lifestyle medicine. They know diet, they know macronutrients, they know carbohydrate, fat, protein. They understand some vitamins and minerals, they get it. But they don't get it when you're looking at the cellular level. What's the outcome of this?
Yeah.
What is the intervention cause? And how does that influence the hormones?
Yeah.
You're one of the very few, and I can only think of maybe three other physicians, literally, that I've interviewed that I'm comfortable with going, you know, like with Jeffrey Bland, and jumping into some questions full on. And I know I'm going to get a good answer. I'm like, okay, this guy's thought about it. This is not something he came up overnight. It took years to really trace the science to know, you know, is this a safe intervention? Who would you rather go see? A practitioner that's like, you know, into the medical technology, knows traditional medicine, but not open to the fact that these nutraceuticals have existed, these herbs, for tens of thousands since the beginning of our genetics, that they may, like Jeffrey Bland says, have a epigenetic influence? Yeah, you might have been dealt a certain genetics and you're like stuck with a disease. No. Jeffrey Bland says, well, wait a minute. What about cancer? What about diabetes? What about autoimmune disease? How do we change those epigenetics?
Yeah.
And what is it? What herbs? What combinations? What concentrations? What dose? And what lifestyle, right?
It's super fascinating that you said all that too, because recently Jeffrey Bland just did a webinar with Metagenics about a journal review of recently there was a publication, New England Journal of Medicine, April of 2018, that looked at, and I think the title of the article is The Role of Epigenetics in Human Disease Mitigation. And I think, you know, by him bringing that into the limelight, New England Journal of Medicine publishing this, it's definitely showing a paradigm shift of, you know, the direction that medicine's going towards, and appreciating that, you know, things aren't as concrete and non-malleable. You know, it's not permanent. We have the ability to go in there and potentially change our trajectory and disease potential, leveraging this information, knowing about, you know, methylation pathways and histone deacetylase and how that influences, you know, gene expression, and giving your body the cofactors. It goes back to good food and decreased stress and movement, you know, the fundamental, and good sleep and hydration. You know, if you could optimize those fundamental domains, it's all good. You know, we're addressing the core issues of lifestyle medicine, whatever you want to call it, you know.
But the problem is Dr. Google has people so mesmerized that they can figure out everything. My good client here, you know, he thinks he knows more than I do after 40 years of experience, and I'll be polite and generous about that, but I'm like, you have a sleep disorder, so why not employ neuro-linguistic programming? Why not use the best in NLP, in timeline therapy, and hypnosis? And you know, he listened to it last night for the first time. He says, is there just music? No, there's a binaural tone.
But,
it's getting the brain into
theta.
From an agitated alpha state to towards theta, which is a high learning state. And then what's next after theta is delta, sleep.
Yeah.
So you listen to it, it takes you through a program. I'm using words that bypass critical thinking. I learned all this from Tony Robbins, not him, but his trainers that trained him, because I wanted to go right to the trainers, because I knew Tony would do it to you, but was he showing you how to do it?
Yeah.
So listening to these downloadable tapes on our
beats,
program,
right
to your phone, listen to them at night. If you wake up after 3 hours and you can't get back to sleep, your mind's too busy.
Yeah.
We all have that affliction.
Sure.
We're in a stressful society.
Yeah, right on.
I'm more stressed as anyone. But we thrive off stress if we know how to handle it. And
absolutely.
My belief about stress is that when people get stressed, they get the nervous nibble. Some overeat, they eat the wrong things,
they
smoke, they take drugs, they abuse their bodies.
Fun stuff.
I teach them, I say, look, when those things, those are triggers to use these jump holes.
They're coping mechanisms.
To help you, though, And I build in language. So I tell them, trust the process. In neuro reprogramming is the hybrid of all of these linguistic trainings. So when I say trust the process, people say, well, I listened to it once and it didn't do anything for me. I said, listen, good clinical intervention at the level of the brain,
yeah.
And you agree, the mind-body connection sure. is huge.
Yeah.
So I say, listen to it for 7 straight times, the same recording every morning or at bedtime or if you wake up early. 7 consecutive times. Now, it takes, what do they say, 30 days to change a behavior. But the reality is, Richard Bandler said, it takes that quick. Once your mind decides, I'm going to start eating raw food while I'm traveling. I'm going to carry a food bag, a Delgado Cool Tip that I've done for 40 years. It takes me an extra 15 minutes to pack the food. I'm giving people advice that people think, oh God, this is so boring. Why am I doing this? How come? Because you know what? It's consistency. Consistency, what goes in my body, what goes into my mind.
Patterns,
and
behavior.
And how I do it, right?
You know.
So does that have an effect? The love that we have, the contribution, the ability to de-stress, the 5-second rule, 5, I'm calm, 4, I'm relaxed, 3, I'm gonna handle the situation, 2, I'm gonna be happy, 1, I'm loving. And when you go through that, when someone's in your face and you forget to do it, I sometimes have to use it 20 times a day.
Yeah.
I mean, there's just people in the environment that they're reacting to what's called a gestalt. And it might have been as a young child or a young adult, someone got in their face and they're looking at you and they're thinking, oh, trigger, I'm gonna fight back.
Yeah.
That's the human organism.
Yeah.
Survival comes first. They're not thinking love first. They're yeah. defend myself, protect myself. So I say, just let the process occur.
Exactly.
And after a few weeks, I find my people going, oh, wow, I started carrying this food bag with me. I started going to organic farms. I started going to Whole Foods. I started reading the labels. I started getting, you know, less than 3 grams of fat per serving. I started getting 100 grams of fiber a day. I started using the infrared spa every day.
Yeah.
I started using, but it all started
with
the brain.
I agree.
If you don't program the mind, I don't care how convinced, and this is where I really learned, Dr. Anil, and this is it. I used to work with Pritikin, 1978, 79, 80. So that's a better part of, what is that? We're 2018, so that's almost 40 years ago, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I trained Bob Whelan, Dennis Esterbrook, and another guy out in the field, and I was out in the field doing lectures every day for 18 straight years, every night going out and doing a talk, right? After a long day, we drive out and, you know, do a talk. And it was announced in the paper and the radio, and people got to know me and all this. And people say, I used to watch your father, listen to your father on radio 40 years ago. That wasn't my father, it was me.
Yeah.
And it was interesting that here was the most dramatic thing I saw. When the educators, salesmen, would enroll people into the 6-week classes, they knew, because they had PowerPoint slides, they knew all this information. This is how we eat, this is exercise, how important, they were convinced. But not at the unconscious level.
Yeah.
The food demonstrators, when they enroll in the class, the ones who prepared the food and had to go to the grocery store and shop and take them to the restaurant and teach them how to order, those people, 40 years later, to this day, still follow a healthy diet, they exercise, they do it all. The educators that were never on the front lines of teaching, you know, face-to-face and going through, here's what you got to go through, you got to pack. If you grab my little food pack there, here, just pull it up, USC, I'm proud that I went to the university. And guess what? Those educators to this day are the health educators, the food demonstrators, I call them, the food preparers. To this day, they still follow, including my mom, she was one of them.
Yeah.
She's 83, 40 years ago she started with me. But the guys who knew the didactic, they knew the science, but they were never trained the neurobiology. If you grab this food, you clean it, this fruits and vegetables, you eat it, you do this, you prepare it, you do however you do it, they're fat, they're overweight. I look at them, I go, dude, you weigh 300 pounds. What happened to you? Oh yeah, you know, life, I got busy and you know.
Yeah.
We all, look, I honor the struggle. This is not an easy road.
Yeah.
But when you take this road and you reinforce it, and you start with that neuro reprogramming, our online course, you do this microscope course, you do the new fat loss and fitness course. I mean, we've got 30 segments in that course. In the acne course, there's 50 segments. And I don't care if you're MD, you're a board certified, or you're lay public, when you go through these courses, you're going, wow, I didn't realize the depth of this. I listen to my own tapes, I go, wow. I didn't realize I was programming people that well because I've been in it for 40 years. So what did I grab today? I have some grapes and cherries. I have some literally fresh artichoke that I baked in a double boiler from my garden. I got a bigger one too, but I brought the little one just because it fit in here. I've got a baked potato, no oil. I got some roasted penna nut hummus. I've got a blue ice. That's where it came up, the Delgado Cool Tote. I just slip it in there. And then down below here, let me just, this isn't boring you, is it kind of weird?
No, no.
Well, you've seen how I eat. You've been to my house.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know this is real. This is like, and this, I do this every day for 40 years. Who do you know that packs their lunch every day for 40 years?
Nobody.
Nobody. Except for some of my graduates, right? So maybe we can set this down here a second. Here, I'll put this on the floor here. Mm-hmm. So I'm just trying to show this because, you know, when you're talking about nutraceuticals and nutrition, I took a crock pot this morning. Early this morning, I wake up crazy early. And it has cauliflower, broccoli, several different kinds of mushrooms. Mushrooms have an adaptogen.
Yeah.
They modulate the white blood cells, good for this particular client.
Yeah.
But he's like, oh, I don't know if
you
need to eat this. There's no fat in it. Do you see any oil dripping around there?
No.
This is a chili salsa. It's got eggplant, tomato, it's got cabbage. It's got all these cool vegetables. You know what the caloric density of this per serving?
Probably really low.
Next to nothing, like 30 calories, 40 calories. Do you realize if you ate this entire container, it'll be satisfying, but you'll get maybe a couple hundred calories.
Yeah.
So what does that do for you? What does that do for your mindset, your clarity? Why, if I put my blood right now in front of you, what do you think you would see in my blood? What do you think you're gonna see?
Nothing.
It's gonna be clean, the terrain, right? Now that brings us back to and pasture. What is your belief about the terrain? Doesn't that set the epigenetics of what's going on, whether we manifest the disease or not, or combat that effectively?
Absolutely. A lot was just said. And I must say that just circling back to the original premise that, I do believe, the biology.
And if you're brave enough, I'll get you a bowl of this.
No, I'll totally down it. But I actually have to get going 10 minutes ago.
Okay.
Real quickly, looking at the biology belief and the concept of how the mind influences everything.
Did you ever meet
Bruce Lipton? I haven't met him in person as yet.
Amazing.
But
I want to interview him next.
He is a phenomenal
individual. He used individual. Electron microscopes.
Oh yeah, yes he did.
Good
and
stuff.
What comes to mind is a quote from Gandhi in regards to your thoughts becomes your words becomes your actions, your actions become your behaviors become who you are as a person.
Yes.
And that drives a lot of, where we're at today. So starting with the thought, and harnessing good thoughts and good energy and good purpose and intent, all cultivated out of love, is going to be first and foremost
love's
one of the most important
things.
That's a universal language.
Emotion.
And with that being said, going back to neurolinguistic programming and how that influences motivational interviewing from a practitioner standpoint, and also just our own actions and behaviors, and doing the things that you do is quite phenomenal because you have a system, you developed a system, the food prep, the just the conscious eating, the mindfulness practice that you've cultivated is huge.
And by the way, you see those dumbbells there?
Oh, yeah.
I hold a going challenge of any athlete in the world come up and head-to-head, let's see if they can outlift me. I take them right down the beach where I keep my body cool.
Yeah.
I stand in the ocean water so I don't overheat because that's one of the keys to incredible endurance and strength. But, being that I'll be 64 in January, my goal is to break my all-time world record. And my main goal is to break the world record for healthy aging. Do you see me doing that? 60 years from now, I'll be older than Gene Calumet, the oldest living, documented, longest lived individual in history, but in good health.
I like it. I hope to see that. I really do.
And you'll be young enough to see me do
I'll
it,
I'll be
bro.
Interviewing you then.
There you go.
But going back to the concept of neurofeedback and reprogramming and enhancing neurocognitive function, there are different brainwave patterns that we are able to cultivate, delta, theta, alpha, beta, right? And knowing how, and measuring that as well through neuroquant EEGs and looking at these different pathways and enhancing neurocognitive function is actually a very popular technique in the functional neurology space and trying to enhance just overall performance, but also prevent dementia and neurocognitive aging. So that's a very important thing right now.
By the way, I prepared for a talk with Daniel Amen that's coming
up.
Wanted to be right at that A level on brain inflammation. So I've got a whole talk on it now that's online. They can see me on YouTube.
Awesome. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's so much information out there. But circling back to the other question that you just proposed, and we could probably close with this, is that, you know, when you look at just the history of medicine in regards to the trajectory we've taken over the past 120 years and whatnot, there's so many different factors that have shaped the direction we've taken. You know, from looking at, you know, the argument that you proposed with Anton Bechamp and Louis Pasteur, germ theory versus terrain theory.
Yes.
Very important concept. And I think it's not one or the other, but a marriage of the two. Because if the microbe has the ability to become extremely virulent if the environment is conducive to its growth.
Correct.
So it is a part of the microbe and it is a part of the terrain. It's not one or the other. It's just the true nature, ecology of everything that's going on. Allopathic medicine takes a very biomechanistic approach to the human frame. It's a machine. We could cut something out, replace it, modify it, change the oil, whatever it is.
Right.
But you know, when you look at Eastern medicine, it takes more of a bioecological perspective of the body and how things manifest is due to, you know, imbalances of that ecology. And I kind of resonate more with the ecology perspective in regards to influencing the terrain, which is directly impacted by the foods that we eat. Our thoughts, our behaviors, our action, our hydration status. So when you're eating, you know, these foods that are rich in phytonutrients and everything else, it's going to have profound effect on the body's balance, pH, and everything else.
And supplements that
and the supplements
that, and
herbs,
of course, that are derived from
turmeric, ginger, all that good stuff. Yeah. There's so many different adaptogenic herbs out there that have so many different functions, and it's just awesome to see. But you know how we got to where we're at today is a really interesting story, because you know, if you were to look at the Flexner Report, which was published in, I don't know, 20s or 30s, sponsored by the Rockefeller Institute, that really changed the shape and trajectory of how we practice medicine today and how it's studied, how it's taught. You know, it standardized medical schools, which I think was a good thing, but it also stomped out a lot of traditional beliefs. And, you know, the fundamental pillars and tenets of what you're professing right now, I think, stands true. You know, the reality is, let your food be your medicine, medicine be your food, said Hippocrates. And, you know, every MD took the Hippocratic oath, you know? So it's interesting how selective we are and what we choose to follow, and emphasize. So with all that being said, I think that, you know, the work that you're doing right now is great. You know, I'm very appreciative of it. And I've been following for years from afar. And I think that thank you for having me today to discuss this. I look forward to future ventures in regards to the microscopy and other coursework that you're looking to develop and helping contribute content to that moving forward. Additionally, you know, if I could chat your ear off about all sorts of random stuff, you know. So
I think I could keep up with you too.
Yeah, I know you could. You know, I think we've definitely taken very similar paths to where we're at today, and I hope to follow in your footsteps in regards to cultivating better habits. Because, man, I like to go out and party. You know, I'll go out and enjoy Korean barbecue and soju and all sorts of, you know, foods that
I'll go party with you. I'll give you a little bit better selection choice.
Yeah, exactly.
You can still eat little bits of, but massively, you know, add the extra, you know, detoxifying vegetables and so forth.
So, but you know, it's very motivating sitting down here with you as well, because I'm going to take from this trip and the time that I spent out here in California with you and, you know, everything else that I've been doing back with me and try to implement more strategic changes in my diet.
You will implement.
Yeah. I will.
It
I am.
Try.
I already have been doing it.
Just like, you know, when I sat down with Terry Grossman, I told you about before we went on the set, Dr. Grossman, he said, you know, it was that interview that kind of turned the light on, said, hey, I got to go up to a higher standard.
Yeah. And it's not to say that I'm doing bad things, but I'm not fully optimized right now.
And I could do better too.
Yeah.
You raised the bar for me too. I'm like, oh yeah, I need to do that test again. Genova lab.
There's so many different things, you know? So thank you very much for having me today. And I look forward to, you know, many more of this to come. Yeah.
We'll go surfing too. Cool. Train a little bit too.
Awesome. Good stuff.
Take care. Dr. Nick here. Check us on iTunes, give us a good review. We're always watching who gives us reviews, and there'll be a prize each week awarded. Unlike my friend Ty Lopez, who's come in for coaching to see me, I may not be giving a Mustang, but I will give you something cool, one of our products of choice, and we're looking forward to support you in your journey, which I admit is a tough journey, but it can be made easier with our help and your guidance. We're available to you because you are the hero. We are simply the guide. Let's get started. Let's do it today.